Hi guys.
Hello, Wildcard. And Gunnar, this one is for you. It's for you to know. So hello. It's been awesome here. Like, yeah. Totally. You're great people.
Yeah.
Truly.
I wouldn't recognize this
is
the word for
me. My bad.
But actually, I think there was something that we wanted to talk about.
Yes. So what are we going to talk about?
Well, let's start with our story of Flora. Close to 2 years ago, we kind of realized that we are not 20 anymore. And we had been around in this IT industry. I've been working in big consulting company. I've been also working in this kind of small agile consultancy, in more or less like managing some part of the business. And Juha?
Yeah, I was working in this huge Nordic service house, service company, doing different kind of things, development, testing, that kind of stuff. But I wasn't really happy there, in a way. I was actually really unhappy.
Yeah, and you also worked in a smaller product company.
Yeah, then I thought that fuck it, I'm leaving. And then I went to this smaller product house, which was nice for a time. And really nice, but it still wasn't the thing that I really wanted to do.
Yeah, all of these places kind of lacked something that we thought we needed. And it made us grumpy, like these guys here sometimes. And we didn't want to stay grumpy. So we decided to find ourselves the perfect work environment, just like we always imagined. And that's how Flora started.
So we'd like to tell you about this another way of working, for real. And this is something that we have practiced for something around a year, maybe a bit more.
Yeah.
So. And I think that this might have a more significant impact than actually adopting the agile ways of working in that sense. And it might, because everybody knows that there's no silver bullets. We know there's no magic thing, and that's pretty much where agile as itself is worth shit, really. Without any stories attached, agile is nothing in that sense. So we are just hoping that we can attach a good story to know employees, which is the thing that we are going to be talking about.
Yeah, and basically our kind of aim or purpose is to encourage each of you, one person is enough, to kind of explore. If you want to find a situation where you can do what you love in the way that you feel is right for you, and kind of to look past the obvious options like applying for another company that you basically have an instinct that it might end up being the same kind of company that you're already working in. So that there's not so obvious options which you might want to try sometimes.
Mm-hmm. Good tip. Sorry.
Okay, now we are on the right page, on the same page. Mm-hmm. Yeah? So maybe we've taken the wrong learning from the success of the really amazing 21st century companies that we all love and admire, like Valve Interactive, like Supercell from Finland, Signals, Google, whatever. Because at least for me, those companies have been like proof of different kind of working, like I've always known, not always, but for some time. It can really work and it can have a great impact. But
it's true.
Would you
mind me saying that these are the companies that are actually in the papers like daily, and these are the companies that people actually say that these do things great and they do great things and that kind of stuff. So it's pretty like interesting thought that maybe we take the wrong stuff from them in that sense and try to.
And maybe I've taken the wrong learning, because in the past like 5 to 10 years I've been going to the big companies with these learnings and there, try to empower people, build self-organizing teams, transform people, teams, and organizations into agile. well, not really personal thing for me, safe, but some of us might have done that too in big corporations too. But and I've had successes, but actually it's also very hard work and takes a lot of time and effort. And maybe if you just want to have a good working environment for yourself, maybe that's too hard work and not leading to the right kind of results. Maybe the old dogs, the big corporations, cannot all learn new tricks. Maybe that's not the way to go about forming the perfect work environment for yourself. I said earlier that changing culture is hard because of the assumptions that people have that they don't know about. So maybe there's an alternative, like having more new dogs instead. More smaller companies, more small new companies.
Yeah, the thing is that this shift is already happening, like for real. Because these big companies, they just can't do the specialized work in that sense. They can't, which is kind of strange. And this leaves it open for these new dogs to come and play with them and actually to do the stuff that the big companies need. So there's like, this shift is already happening. There's plenty of opportunities for these new dogs to come and maybe will help or at least participate in doing stuff with the big companies in that sense. That's already happening.
Yeah, and there's other things in the market too, like more and more companies adopting practices like waste transparency, making the organizations flatter, even though in some of the organizations where I might have been, kind of saying that you're flat doesn't really make you flat if you have one CEO owner at the top. It's flatter, not flat. And of course there's really, really genuinely innovative organizations like Cocoon Project from Italy, which has no boundaries. You can just start working there and not tell everybody, and then you're part of the company. Crisp from Stockholm, Happy Melly, that Jürgen Appelo started, and so on.
Yeah. So those are new dogs, and we have our own. We have a new dog.
Yeah,
but it's the no employees.
No employees is our kind of mode of working, and it's started because we are small. We are four people, and we are new. We decided to kind of take all the challenges of traditional organization, dysfunctions and so on, and try to form a really simple example solution. And this is our simple solution that we have come up with so far. And what is no employees? Well, in traditional organizations, you have the three basic roles of owners. Well, they make by default all the decisions, the majority of the owners. And they might do the work of the company too, in smaller companies at least. But in larger companies, they are mostly shareholders who are kind of outside of the company in a way, even though they have the largest decision-making powers. And then there's managers to whom the owners delegate some of the decision-making power. And managers coordinate the work of employees, which is the kind of the most specialized general role in an organization, because they don't make any decisions, they just do the work.
So wait a minute, you're saying that the employee is the specialized role in the organization?
Yeah.
Hold that thought for a while, because that's interesting. Because this is the so-called Taylor stick model of management. And everybody knows that this is suits like particularly bad in knowledge work in that sense. Because you hire smart, you hire intelligent people, and then you take the other capability away from them to do actual decisions that affect their work, which is quite insane, but that's how we do stuff in most organizations anyway. It's kind of strange. And that is actually oppressive, I think. That's something that causes oppression, and it's sometimes violent even. In that sense, if you're like unhappy or something in your organization, I would say that you are violently oppressed in many cases. And hardly anyone wants to be violently oppressed at work. Hardly anyone, I think. So I think this is something that should be resisted, like really. And maybe like going to making up and taking things to your own hands and doing things differently would be a way to actually kind of resist these kind of things.
Yeah, but this form of management is mostly between managers and employees. Mm-hmm. But there's also a conflict between employees, including the managers and owners. And this is highlighted by Thomas Piketty in his book that came out 2 years ago, Capital in the 21st Century, where he kind of pointed out the fact that the last 50 years of 20th century has been an anomaly in the sense that that's the only time in economic history where the interests and needs of employees and owners of companies have actually aligned, and that time has now changed since we have gone into the 21st century. As you can see from this graph, it's from the US, and it's just a small detail, but it illuminates the fact that starting from the year 2000, in the US companies, the way that the company's output, financial output, has gone to profit margins and to labor share, it has started to diverge. And so that's one detail that illuminates the conflicting interests of employers and owners and shareholders, particularly.
And basically what comes to Taylorism, in the sense, as you said, that it was mainly conflict between managers and employees in that sense. But this is actually like a conflict between the owners and employees, as we include the managers to be employees in that sense also. So, and that gap is a really bad thing, in my opinion, in that sense.
So, when we started to think about our model of working, well, as the no employees title says, we decided that we don't want that specialized role of employees, just people that would do the work that don't make decisions. But as soon as we made the decision, we found out that, well, if you don't have employees, we don't need managers, because we don't need anybody to coordinate the employees' work. So, and then we just said that, okay, we need to have, maybe the owner role is redundant also.
It's sort of like domino effect in that sense. You take away the specialist role, then everybody else falls down also. It's quite simple.
So we just have one role that we call fellow, and this is actually not to Bob Marshall, flow change sensei, who has kind of experimented with a similar model in his company. And kind of how to do it? Well, it's pretty simple. We have four principles. First is the shared ownership. Well, Flova needs to be owned by all of us, more or less equally. We don't kind of have strict rules that it has to be equal ownership. We have been talking about different models, but as for now, because we want to keep it simple, we are currently, it's equal ownership, but we are open to different kind of models like liquid equity. But so far, that question hasn't interested us enough to make a complicated model. And of course, to be a really no-employees company, we need to have a principle not to have employees in the future either. So if you want to invite a new fellow into our company, we need to have a path for him or her to get a share of the company, more or less equal share. Otherwise, we would have start to be a yes employees company, of course. And the third part is shared work. We don't want to have owners either. So everybody who is a fellow needs to take part in the shared work that we have. So as not to get into this other people working for others' profit mode.
Which is quite usual in companies.
And the last is transparency, like to keep ourselves honest. We want to kind of be public about our principles, so that anybody can point to us. We are really not doing this, you are just cheating. And of course, if somebody should want to copy some of this, it's easier if there's material available on how we do it. Yeah.
And basically it comes down to transparency also, because we are criticized quite much when we are talking about this knowing place thing, that okay, you are just four persons. You're just four people and you are founders. Of course you don't have any employees in that sense. Which is true in a sense. But you will see that there's much more, well not much because this is quite simple, but some stuff also happening which makes it kind of a system that steers us towards. And that's also something to remember for the future, this system thinking, system thing.
Voting
to organizations. So?
Yeah. Well, those were the principles. What had really happened? We have been operating more or less for a year now, right now, so we have some kind of stories to tell already.
Yeah. So, as I was saying, I was working in this pretty large service house, really, and there was lots of talking about this freedom versus responsibility thing. I don't know if any of you is in the similar situation, but that was widely talked about, and that was identified as one of the key points of not doing well in that sense, because people didn't have the responsibility, but that would have also meant that people should have been given the freedom to do things, but that wasn't like possible in those situations. But now I really do have that freedom and I really do have that responsibility, because everything that I do as a fellow has like the direct effect to the whole of the company and how it works in that sense.
Yeah.
And I can also take a free day if I want to, which was also discussed in this one.
And I don't have to kind of worry that he takes the decision based on kind of not caring, because he owns a quarter of the company, so naturally he's thinking about the well-being of our company. So.
Yeah, and then there's also the subject of profit. As an employee, I never did any profit. Now we do, suddenly, in that sense.
Yeah, it has been
pretty nice.
Yeah, challenging path to that, but yeah.
Yeah, but eventually we made it. And there's the thing of fellowship. As we said, that we are fellows in our company, like really, but it's not restricted to our company, not in any way, and this is something that is quite peculiar and interesting, really, because of this thing.
Yeah, when we started to kind of talk about this, we kind of hoped to have this kind of effect, but what emerged took us by surprise, because we didn't know what to think about, and it was a good surprise, because we have had lots of contacts from people and companies that kind of want to sell our offering. Either they want to collaborate with us to work for some customer case, or they just want to sell our kind of what we can do. And this has been really cool. Also, we have collaboration opportunities with startups who want us as a company to be founder of the startup. So this is very good.
Yeah, there's actually like shitload of opportunities out there. I'm just amazed at how these big companies can let them pass, really. There's quite much stuff to just go and grab them, for real. It's
yeah,
really nice.
And we think that part of this is that we are four people, but we all have different kind of networks and of people that we know. We are interested in different things and different technologies. So the opportunities are multiplied by four. And because we don't have a strict kind of decision-making system that I have to get okay from Juha and Ari-Pekka and Tero to talk further about the collaboration opportunity, I can just say that, yeah, we are interested and let's talk more and let's try something. So it makes it, for other parties, really easy to collaborate with us.
Yep. think when talking about like entrepreneurship companies and that kind of stuff, people usually ask about growth. That what are your plans on growing and that kind of stuff. Because it's basically how we are wired in a way. That's how capitalism works in a sense, the continuous growth. That's what has been taught to me at schools, at least.
Yeah, and it's also part of humanity.
Yep.
We all want to be part of starting great things, building great things, building big organizations, having big impact on the world. So it's something that we embrace.
Yeah. And there was another thing, like Maslow was talking about these social values in companies at the presentation here. And basically it's one way to grow and one way to increase impact, really, as he said, which was really nice. And it just might be worth to pass the good around. Mm-hmm. If you find something good, just pass it around, and that's a good way to grow also.
Yeah.
Really.
So. But as we are no employees company, probably we are not going to grow by hiring lots of developers and selling their work. That's not our thing. But as I've seen a lot of IT companies in Finland at least, they like to grow this traditional way with the headcount and having numerous projects with lots of people. I don't really see a lot of growth, a lot of exponential growth. I don't see a lot of growth in impact. This is just, for me, at least in some companies, it's more like growing like a cancer. If you understand what I'm saying. So it has no purpose, or it seems that it has no purpose.
Mm-hmm.
It's just to make the numbers bigger. But the idea is to increase impact, right? So we scale outwards. As we said, we have had a lot of collaboration opportunities outside, and we have also formed strong partnerships with a couple of companies. So kind of our mode of growing is not to grow ourselves, but grow with the similar-minded companies, some of which are quite similar to us and really small, some of who are a little bit bigger and kind of see the opportunity of working with us to be very good.
Yeah. And then about the growing thing, we have been thinking about something else too, in that sense. This might interest some of you.
Yeah.
Hopefully.
Yeah, this part is all hypothetical because we just started to think about this when we read the Frederick Laloux's Reinventing Organizations book and heard about Burtsorg or whatever the Netherlands pronunciation of that company is. It's a healthcare company, kind of neighborhood nurses, and they started with a cell of four people in 2007, and right now they have, in last year they had 9,000 people in 800 cells or pods. And they didn't grow by taking new employees. When somebody wanted to join them, they told them that, okay, gather like 5 to 7 like-minded people from your area and start your own cell or your own pod. And then we can help you, we can coach you to our way of working. So, and this kind of model sounds very, very good to us. And
that's like really intriguing. I'm like so much into this way of increasing impact and this way of growing rather than growing in the number of employees or that kind of stuff, because it would grant the people the autonomy that they need.
Yeah. And kind of the basis of this growth that we had and maybe can have is trust. And we found out that actually this model and our principles has grown trust with our partners. And because we are not seen as competition, we are not going to steal any consultancy company's employees.
Because we have none?
Yeah. And we are not going to steal their business because we have no capability of supporting kind of like software projects where you need 20 PHP developers or whatever, but we are seen as potential collaborations and added value to the companies, and they can see that they can together we can have a kind of win-win scenarios. So we are not operating with the same business model as them.
Yeah, basically. But it's not without challenges. And as you can see, they are weird. Well, not actually, they are quite traditional, to be honest.
Yeah.
One of them being the communication. And because we don't have like the specialized roles for handling communication, for handling the early management stuff and that kind of stuff. So basically, communication is something that takes a shitload of time. It takes really much of our time, but we don't think it as an overhead for things that we do. Like in normal companies, people are always complaining about meetings, complaining about talking about things, even taking time, and that's strange, in a way. But instead, we treat the communication as a system again. And it's something that we are continuously trying to improve, and that's the way how we are going or trying to tackle the problems of communication or the issue of communication in that sense. And it has yielded some good results, actually, which is nice.
Yeah, and kind of the next problem is an interesting one because it's about shared purpose. And it's a problem because much of our success has been due to the freedom and agency of each of us individually, that we are able to take on opportunities by ourselves without having a consensus. Then the problem might be that I want to play basketball and Juha wants to ride a bicycle and we're actually not doing anything together. So we might have a greater impact with more focus on one thing at a time, but we are really kind of careful not to ruin a good thing that we have going at the moment. So we are getting small steps to kind of get more focus and shared purpose. Actually, in the value sense, we have a shared purpose, but not necessarily on the kind of, we are not limiting WIP, work in progress, enough at the moment. Mm-hmm. But that's kind of a balance between freedom and focus.
And then there's quite traditional issue for companies to at least try to be great. Yeah. I'm not sure that every company actually tries to be great. In that sense, they should, really, I think.
Yeah, and it's, I've seen companies that can only see this mode, but yeah. But that's natural when you are in struggle.
That's true, and it's basically because there's this survival thing, paying wages and that kind of stuff. But then there's also the grasping for the greatness, in the sense that because of all the opportunity that's all the opportunities that come along, because they are not without risk, not really. So there's always this like cost between survival and greatness in that sense. Can't survive without achieving greatness, I think.
Yeah, and it's like, do we save all our profits to be able to last for longer, or do we invest our profits to be more awesome tomorrow? It's not an easy choice.
Yeah, and then there's the issue of minimum viable organization, which is like really nice term.
Yeah, because you need some kind of structure to have an organization and not just a bunch of people, but what is enough? And we are trying all the time to steer away from consensus, have consensus as late as possible at the last responsible moment so that we are not bogging down on decision making and having emerging planning, but you need something, you need some focus. So there's a kind of balance between these.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
Okay, let's go to have a beer.
Can we?
Okay, couple of slides more, but
just a few slides.
Yeah, we are going to summarize this and then then spears.
And now there comes the stuff for you guys, really. That comes like now.
Yeah, what do we really have to kind of tell you about our experiment?
Yeah, because this was all about us. This was our experience for trying out something new in that sense. And it's important that we get to tell it in any way, because we kind of like to think that we succeeded, at least for this firm.
So far.
So things can be done, really. That's kind of an important thing to know, that things can be done.
Yeah. Kind of the first thing to note is that there are alternatives to kind of going to the old corporations and try to make them new and hip and cool. And maybe better ways to spend your energy to get into a good work situation. You can start something new, and that's relatively easy if you start with a small experiment. Because we started our experiment whilst working in other companies. So.
Mm-hmm. And then the actual thing is that the organization that you are working in, or the brand, actually, it's quite small. So really small in the sense that it's the people who are working inside the organization and people working inside the brand, they are actually what makes it big. So the people are actually great and big in that sense.
Some companies like to inflate their brand, but it's, you can probably see when it's kind of not genuine.
Yeah, just remember that if you are working inside your organization, it's you that is actually great.
The companies come and go, but people, at least in Finland in our industry, you see the same people in different companies all the time.
Yeah, that's true. So basically, just be your super self, because you are, in the way. Every one of you is a unicorn in that sense, that you can actually like be your super self and try to impose that, but try not to be an asshole, really.
Being yourself does not give you a free pass on being a prick or asshole. I think we all kind of know that because we have gone to high school and that, but that's always good to just make note of.
Yeah. Be mindful towards others. That's the thing. And that's actually something that correlates with this one.
Yeah.
Because as we said, that we are a system in a way. Clever is a different system, really. And it has worked for us to design that system so that it would actually generate greatness for others.
Yeah. And it's just to think about what you want to do and how could you do it in a way that you get to collaborate with all the cool people and companies and not to compete with them. Because, well, like in the traditional competition, big companies with big law departments, they are going to win some battles at least. But if you can get to the collaboration mode, then you can flourish.
Yep.
Yeah, and that's where you can build trust and partnerships. And it's easier if your model is not the same as everyone else's, if you are doing something different. Yeah, and just final word. I think we need more experimental organizations. As you can see that no employee is not a silver bullet. It's not for everyone, it's for us. I don't know if it's for anybody else. But it's just an experiment that we started. And I think we need much more to know what organizations are now and tomorrow.
Yeah, because every single one of you has tons of experiments inside anyway. So you might as well go and try some out for real.
Yeah, and
thanks.
That's everything. And just to say that we are always, Flava is always open to hear about collaboration opportunities with everybody.
Yep, we like you.
So one question, one of the first slides, you actually had SAFE, where the SAFE was written three letters with capital and the one with a smaller one. So I have a question, is there a specific meaning under it?
Scaled Agile Framework, I think.
SAFE, yeah, something. Could you repeat?
Scaled Agile Framework. Is it scaled?
And the second one, then, can you give an example of what you do? Like, so people have a bit easier to relate to.
Like, this one,
collaboration policy, or what do you do to the data you're not keeping?
Yeah. One thing I do, I do Kanban coaching with a coach from other company that actually solved the case together to this public company in Finland.
Mm-hmm. Thing, what we actually do as a flower in words of collaboration. Does anyone of you know Starter Squad?
Okay. No. But just to be concrete, you know, it's working with the team, developing software and trying to help them to learn better ways of developing.
Yep.
There's one US startup that we are developing the service for enclosure.
Enclosure, yeah. Yep. And then we get some startups kind of asking for the CTO thingy, where our company would actually act as a CTO for the startup, which is quite interesting.
And you and Ari-Pekka are currently Scrum Masters in customer teams, different ones, with different customers, but yeah.
So if I try to rephrase it, it could be like you do like self-employed projects you want to do, you just happen to be a team while doing that, either.
Yeah.
Either you all work on the same thing or slightly different, but still a team.
Yeah.
Okay. Anyone else?
My God, how many questions?
Okay, gracias. I have three questions. How many can I ask?
Stop.
Okay.
Listen one and then we'll decide.
Okay, but not nice questions as this girl asked. First question, people are not equal. And you are saying a new person is joining the company and the person gets, I presume, equal share. So is this fair? Because one person may do better or more work than the other. Definitely. How are you going to deal with this fact?
Yeah, this is awkward because I disagree with you on the thing that people aren't equal, in the sense that you can design the system so that it aims for people to be equal in the share that they can actually work, so everyone could work their share. Anthony has a better answer, so he's going to take the mic. That's my opinion.
Actually, kind of like part of the problem is solved before we take in more people, because that principle makes us really picky on inviting new people. So we are not going to just invite anybody. We are being really picky, and not equal shares is the kind of target condition. It doesn't have to be like from day one. And not exactly equal. But right now we are working with equal shares because that's the simplest thing, and there hasn't been a need to work a more complex system. Did it answer your part of your question?
Yeah, it's kind of an answer. Thanks. Next question. Worst question. So, let's not take like big enterprises, like companies, like smaller companies, small or middle companies. And you think if they employed, if they used this non-employees model, would they be any better at what they do? Would they get better services? Would they provide better services? Would they make better products and so on? Did I make myself clear? No?
Yeah, I understand.
I'm just thinking that how much could we charge for the consultancy for our employees model? Maybe we could offer like certificates and that kind of stuff also. Many people do that, it's quite profitable for you.
Yeah, we are not saying that it would be, but I have personal experience with a flat organization with this CEO owner role, and I can say that it's can sub-optimize the whole organization quite a lot. Mm-hmm. So this might help, but we are not saying that you should just apply this in another company without thinking for yourselves why you do it and how you do it. So this is not the kind of saying that you should all be starting no employees companies or making your own company no employees company.
Okay, I have another question, very simple. Have you heard of the country where everybody was called fellows or actually comrades and everything was shared? Do you know what happened to it?
Yeah, I think our country had a really special relationship with this country for many years, so which might have led to suboptimal results for both, even though got quite good economic effect for in the 80s, but
yeah. But the thing is that even if we get some money, we are trying to do something good with it. We're trying to share the stuff outside the organization in the way that interested. We're not trying to hoard it inside. In that
sense. And we are not trying to make anybody else do it. It's just it's all voluntary. No kind of these kind of revolutions.
So the slight differences.
May I ask how would you define difference between your company and freelancing? Aren't you just kind of like a bunch of freelancers working together and sharing the, because you said you work on different projects, all you do in the end is share the results or the money, let's say. So how come, like, what is different between being a freelancer and working in your company? Do you understand?
Yeah. I'm sure somebody would say that there's no problem, kind of no difference. But I would say that we are kind of committed for this experiment, and kind of like what each of us makes in profit has no kind of correlation of how much we are paid. We are kind of deciding our pace in a different way. We didn't talk about it here because that doesn't at the moment interest us so much. We want to get our needs covered, and we can do that and we can get a profit. But our kind of idea is to have a bigger impact and to get each of us, we have kind of aligned personal goals or what we want to achieve, and we've kind of all committed as Flora being our primary vessel at this moment for those goals.
Yeah. Because in this sense, the most important thing is that the Flora as a company is a legal person in that sense. So Flora is the participant in all the deals and that kind of stuff.